Okay, so in this video, I'd like to talk about Gauss quadrature, okay, for numerical integration. So recall for a function g of x that with numerical integration, we approximate the integral of that function g of x as the sum over some number of integration points where we evaluate that function at locations xi and then multiply by some corresponding weight wi. Okay, so Gauss quadrature rules give optimal values of locations and weights to ensure very high orders of accuracy for simple polynomials, i.e., functions of the form constant times x to the nth power plus dot 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 constant times x squared plus another constant times x to the first power plus another constant times x to the zeroth power, or just a constant, right? And there's really three classes of Gauss quadrature, or three basic classes. There's a lot of other numerical integration out there, more than you probably care to know. All right, but I'll talk about Legendre, Lobato, and Radal, okay, which we commonly see in OpenSees, okay, and elsewhere. So Gauss-Legendre quadrature, commonly just referred to as Gauss integration, gives the highest order of accuracy for the fewest number of integration points among these three basic classes of Gauss quadrature. Okay, then we'll go into details, but for a given number of n points, all right, the highest order polynomial that Gauss integration can represent exactly is of the order 2n minus 1, i.e., any function of simple polynomial form can be integrated exactly. Any function of some constant times x to the 2n minus 1 power plus dot dot dot, x to the 2n minus 2, 2n minus 3, down to x squared plus x plus a0. Okay, so for example, if we had a 3-point Gauss integration rule, all right, we could integrate up to a fifth order polynomial, all right, because 2np minus 1, if that's 3, this is going to be equal to 5. Okay, although we rarely come across that in structural engineering practice. All right. And the locations and weights of Gauss integration are tabulated in mathematical textbooks. All right. So this is a reference to the famous Abramovitz and Stegen manual. Okay. But they're often defined in a natural or isoperimetric domain, negative 1 to 1. Okay. And I'm showing here the locations and weights of 2, 3, and 4-point Gauss integration, all right, on the natural domain from negative 1 to 1, negative 1 to 1, negative 1 to 1. All right, but for 2 points, right, we have 1 point at negative 0.577. I'm rounding, all right. There's a lot more digits out there, all right, and then at positive 0.577, and the weights are 1 and 1. All right, these are on, again, an isoperimetric domain, okay, which we can map out to an element. All right, 3 points, there's one in the middle, and then two off center, and then these are the weights. All right, 4 points, again, symmetric, but off center, plus minus, and then off center again. All right, for 5 points, we have different locations and weights, all right, and so on. Okay, all right. Gauss-Lobato, all right, is a variant on Gauss-Legendre, all right, where we constrain two integration points to be always at negative 1 and 1 in our isoperimetric domain. All right, and again, without getting into details, we give up 2 degrees of freedom. All right, so the highest order polynomial we can integrate is 2n minus 3 instead of 2n minus 1. Okay, but for 2-point Gauss-Lobato, all right, we have a location at negative 1 and 1, and then the weights are both equal to 1 in the isoperimetric domain. Okay, 3 points, it's basically Simpson's rule, all right, but these are the points and weights. Okay, and then 4-point Lobato, again, we have points at negative 1 and 1, all right, and then in the middle at some optimal locations, with these weights shown down here. Okay. And as you probably know, or may have seen if you've used OpenSees before, the Gauss-Lobato quadrature, all right, is used frequently in force-based frame elements because it puts integration points at the ends of the element where we know we have the largest bending moments in the absence of member loads. Okay. And then the last variant is Gauss-Radel integration. All right, this is an unsymmetric integration rule. All right, that places an integration point at only one end of the element. All right, let's say at negative one in the natural domain. Okay, so we're only giving up one degree of freedom. All right, so the highest order polynomial we can integrate is 2n minus 2 instead of 2n minus 3 for Lobato or 2n minus 1 for Legendre. Okay, then the points and locations are shown down here. Okay, so for 2 points, we have a point at negative one and then somewhere off center. And then these are the weights. All right, 3 points, again, constrained one at negative one point at negative one. And then points off center with these weights. All right, again, everything's rounded to three significant digits. All right. And then 4 points. Again, a negative one and then three off-center points with these weights shown down here. Okay, so Gauss-Radel is not commonly used in finite element formulations, but it's used for plastic hinge integration and force-based frame elements where we map basically this two-point rule into a plastic hinge region, which we'll talk about in a later lecture. Okay. And then the final point I wanted to make was, with these integration rules defined on the natural or isoparametric domain, we need to map those into an integration domain. All right, so going from negative 1 to 1 into a domain from A to B. Okay, and you can write this as a linear transformation. All right, as shown up here. Okay. But basically, right, if this is x and that's c, I can show you how you get this equation, right? You would say x at a, excuse me, we have a transformation of the form x equals alpha c plus beta. I'm bad with Greek symbols, all right, but bear with me. But if you said x at negative one is equal to a, right, this point right here, right, that's going to be alpha times negative one plus beta, all right, and then x at one, which is here, all right, is going to be equal to b, which is alpha times one plus beta, right. And then you can add these two equations together, right? You get two beta equals a plus b, beta equals a plus b over two, right? And then you can substitute that back in and you get that alpha is b minus a over two. Okay, and that's where this equation here comes from. So that maps the points, all right, from the natural domain to the integration domain, a to b. All right, and then the integration weights or the transformation of the integration weights is just the Jacobian of that transformation. So just take that, scaling. All right, so this 8.6 up here is shifting and scaling. All right, and then 8.7 just represents the scaling. Okay, so for the common case of a line finite element of length L, right, where the domain is from 0 to L, all right, we can just set A equals 0 and B equal to L, right? The transformation from the natural domain to the element domain just reduces down to this and the weights. Going from negative 1 to 1 to 0 to L, you just get these two equations, right? Which is just, A equals 0, B equals L from up there. Okay, so I think that's it, and thank you for watching.